convinced I could get used to a lifestyle like this, drifting around the country houses of Ireland in my shiny status symbol. This house, Castle Coole, was a status symbol too. When the first Earl of Belmore built it, he was making a statement about his wealth and position by proving that he could afford to build such a grand and expensive house at the top of a hill here just outside Enniskillen and overlooking Loch Coole. I've come to realise that it's a house of great quality, from the architect who designed it, to the stonemasons who worked this wonderful Portland stone, to the craftsmen who perfected the interior design and furniture and fabrics. But there's more to a house like Castle Coole than just the design and the decoration. It's the family who breathed life into this house over the last 200 years, the Belmores. So come with me now, and in the next 20 minutes, we'll find out more about them, their home, and the way they lived.
Well, we know from records that a certain John Curry, who I think had made quite a lot of money in Belfast in the 1640s, 50s, he bought 1,000 Irish acres off, I think, a speculator down here. And it turns out to be the area that this house sits on now and Loch Coole. And he bought this land in 1656 for about £800, which then I think was probably a lot of money. And the family have been here ever since. This house was built between 1789 and 1797-98. And it was designed by James Wyatt, an English architect who was very influenced by the French architecture of Louis XVI. Indeed, he went to Versailles. And if you look at this house from the outside, you will see that very strong French influence. Wyatt was a very grand architect, and it's rather like ordering a Rolls Royce or a Ferrari. You couldn't really go much higher. And he was so grand, indeed, he never actually came to Castle Coole. He sent all his plans over. And in 1797, the house was complete, but hardly furnished. The first Lord Belmore broke himself financially in building this house. There's no wonder, because not only was the Portland stone imported at vast expense, but the joinery work, which is one of those hidden extras we all probably know about, I think caught him by surprise. And he died in about 1802, and it wasn't until about 1820 that his son was able to furnish this house with rental money from the Tyrone estates.
Castle Coole has no formal gardens. The ideal of this Palladian style was that you would step out of a meadow into a mansion. It's a very grand and formal house, perhaps even a bit austere. An early visitor said that it was a temple fit for the gods to live in, maybe not so comfortable for ordinary human beings.
Well, the house is 100 yards long. It's got 116 rooms in it, and the one we're in, which is the main hall, and of course is the largest room in the house, it would contain the usable airspace of two normal bungalows just within this room alone. Families tend not to live in the main rooms, of which this is one, but in the wings, where the rooms were, although still large, smaller, and where they had more, if you like, home comforts.
Well, in the main block of the house, you will find what they call the principal rooms, at least on the ground floor. And the principal rooms were designed to be your very best, your grandest rooms, where you did your grandest sort of entertaining. The room we're in at the moment, the saloon, an unfortunate name, because one immediately thinks of swing doors and Summer in the Wild West film, but in fact it's called the saloon on the Wyatt plan. It's an oval-shaped room, and its influence is a similar room in a palace in Rome, in Palazzo Barberini, and Wyatt has scaled it down for Castle Coole. we have a suite of three rooms, very grand, very formal, all facing north, northwest, in fact, so in the wintertime they're bitterly cold. But on a day like this, you don't notice that, and of course the view goes down to Loch Coole.
These formal rooms are so elegant and gracious, but can you imagine what it would be like to look after a house of this size without all our modern conveniences?
Well, in those days, of course, there was no electricity, and lighting was much more subdued than we're used to nowadays. And for that reason, these houses were sited to take the best advantage of the natural light. So the rooms that would be used in the morning faced the east, and the rooms that would be used in the evening faced the west. And this hall faces the east and gets the morning light. The saloon that you see through the door there faces the west and gets the evening light. Those lights, of course, faded in the evening, and then candles and oil lamps were brought in. There was one man whose job in this house was to do nothing but clean and light the oil lamps. That was his entire work, just as one man did nothing but clean and stoke and light the fires, all 116 of them.
Charlie Battle remembers when there were lots of servants at Castle Coole. He came here to work in 1928.
The large kitchen years ago, which is a great height, like.
Isn't it? Enormous. Look at the vaults up there.
That's right. And this, all the places, the presses and all for the thing, they had their huge range there. Used to be a huge range. And this is the larders here, in here.
That's right. And I think the larder's still there. Yes.
Yeah.
And it's got all these meat hooks and things.
That's right. Used to keep all the stuff.
That's right.
But there's no fridge in them days.
No.
And the huge windows, if you know.
And all the food was taken from here all the way up to the dining room.
On trays, right through, up them steps.
You must have had to run jolly fast, didn't you, to get it up there?
That's right, especially with an omelette on.
You can see how the solid stone floor of the entrance hall has been worn away by generations of servants hurrying to and fro.
Well, if you think 200 years ago, even 100 years ago, there was very little outside the estate walls in the way of employment. Conditions were fairly poor. The whole countryside really consisted of estates all joining each other. And in many ways, service in a grand house like this would be something similar to service in the civil service nowadays. And just as in these days, a good, steady, reliable job with a check coming in each month in the civil service is sought after, so employment in these houses was sought after, and nobody thought it demeaning at all, because the alternative was not very nice. I mean, people working here were sure of 3 square meals a day, clothes, warmth, decent accommodation. They had to work hard and long hours for it then, but so did everybody else in those days.
This is the butler's pantry. Of course, a lot of changes since then, like, it's all this stuff here. There used to be a huge table here around about. It was for cleaning silver and different things, like.
Oh, yes.
And there are all the presses there, the silver press. We used to keep the...
Oh, were they?
All the silver, silver trays. The pottery's in use.
Yes. And here's an old inventory of knives and what have you.
That's right, what was
which
there?
Which must have been here. Someone's...
Everything was checked every night.
Yes.
All the silver,
yes.
Spoons, everything else.
Yes.
And was put it into a book, like, does the butler do that?
Oh, I see.
If we lost one spoon, we'd have to chase around and see where it is.
Oh, dear, yes. Well,
which was quite right.
Yes. Well, I suppose it was.
That's right.
So, there are some...
There's more presses here.
Yes, there are more presses here. It's extraordinary. It's the original paint,
that's
isn't it?
That's the same paint.
Yes, amazing. All sorts of funny things.
All the names.
Funny. Good gracious. I hope you didn't ever write your name here, did you?
It might be there.
Good God, I think you did. Look.
Sea Battle.
Yeah. Footman.
Footman, that's right.
Well, that's amazing, isn't it?
1929.
That's right. Time stands still here, I'm afraid.
It's Footman and valet to the Honourable Cecil Curry. That's the Earl of Belmore's brother. The breakfast time, you see, you'd bring the dishes from a table outside where they'd be brought up from the kitchen down below.
And then we'd bring it in here and put it on the table there, over there. And the lamps would be lit with little spirit lamps underneath, a hot plate. And just to keep it hot. And then the butler would announce the breakfast being on the table, like, you know. The family come in then in dribs and drabs, and as they got up, like, you know, used to get up at breakfast 9 o'clock, they'd be up about 8:30, some of them. And then they used to keep it hot there, maybe they'd be 9:30 or more before they come in, like.
Upstairs and downstairs was the expression used to describe the differences between the family upstairs and the staff downstairs who looked after them. But both groups were closely linked and totally dependent on one another. At Castle Coole, that link is clearly demonstrated by the tunnel which leads from the house to the estate buildings.
It was originally dug in order to get the earth out of the huge pit for the foundations of the house. And there really was a huge pit, bearing in mind it was dug by hand and carted away with horses and carts. It
must have been tons and tons.
Hundreds of tons. It was 120 yards long, about 30 yards wide and 30 foot deep. Then, of course, once all the soil was away, all the stone for the basement came in this way as well. And the house was built up to ground level, and then after that they brought the stone in at that level. They then roofed this over, and if you look up, you'll see it's about 8 foot thick, solid brick and stone. And they turned these huge areas on either side here into the fuel stores. But the whole idea of the tunnel was that the servants and so on should not be seen above ground. All the supplies, the fuel that we've talked about, candles which were made on the estate, the beef that was killed and cured on the estate, the butter, all the food and supplies from the house came in this way, and the servants themselves. So the house was seen almost to operate independent of any human agency. It just was there. A mansion in a meadow, which was James Wyatt's brief for the house from the first Earl of Belmore.
The tunnel leads down to the farmyard buildings, which are tucked away out of sight of the house. It's said that in its heyday, the estate could produce everything that was needed in the house except tea and sugar, which had to be brought in from outside. Back inside the house, the family and their guests could admire these elegant surroundings without seeing all the frantic activity behind the scenes. For them, life was orderly, unhurried and calm. There was always a feeling of great space. When Wyatt designed the upstairs landing, which he called the lobby, he made sure it was light and airy and spacious, and being Castle Coole, also ornate.
Wonderful space, isn't it? Wonderfully extravagant space, really servicing just two rooms. You start in this floor, very simple oak floor, working your way up through the elaborately decorated door frames, wonderful solid mahogany doors, past the four stoves. Now, I say four, but actually only two of them are real. This was their version of central heating in 1790. But in order to make it symmetric, to make it all look even, they put in two fakes. On up to the very decorated cornice, and this wonderful skylight with the sun streaming through. You can stand here for hours watching the clouds float by.
There are a lot of columns. I presume they don't need all these to hold the roof up.
No. It's a sense of proportion and order and decoration and what the architect thought would look rather grand but right.
Rather grand but right is this scene in the drawing room. Joan Trimble is playing a piece of Beethoven on the piano. The music was written when both the piano and this house were new. Which the ladies of the family would have used as a sitting room. They could come here to get away from the men and have a private natter. They would read books and probably do some sewing, because although they didn't work, they were never idle for very long. It's probably the most comfortable room in the house because it's not too grand and it's not so big that you couldn't heat it. And best of all, it's really got a splendid view out of the window towards Loch Coole. There's an interesting story about Loch Coole. When the Belmores first came here in the 17th century, they brought with them a flock of grey-lag geese. The story goes that if the grey-lag geese leave the loch, then the Belmores will leave Castle Coole and their family will die out. The Belmore family are still here at Castle Coole, but since 1951, the house has been owned by the National Trust.
Well, it's made an enormous difference. It's really meant the survival of this house. And it's also made the house available to the general public. I mean, for half the year, anybody at all can come along and pay their entrance fee, and they can see some of the finest architecture and furniture in Ireland.
The Trust has to think in timescales longer than the average person would normally think. For example, we must try and preserve all the contents of this house as long as it's possible to do so. And for that reason, we have to be very careful about the amount of light that comes into our house, because light will destroy curtains, it'll fade carpets, it'll do an immense amount of damage over a very long period of time.
The National Trust has restored Castle Coole both outside and in to its original splendour. They take great care with every detail. There's even a right way and a wrong way to clean books.
Yes, you have to watch how you take the book from the shelf, that you don't catch it by the back of the book. You have to move a book on either side back so that you can catch a good grip on the book and lift the book out and hold it with both hands and then set it down, clean it then.
Well, that's sort of day-to-day cleaning, but you have to put an awful lot more effort in when you're opening up the house for the first time for visitors.
Yes.
So what has happened to the house?
The house, in the winter time, the house goes to bed and everything has its individual cover and everything's covered up and the ceramics are all wrapped in tissue paper and put into tea chests and kept for the winter, and then when it's ready for time to open the house, you have to take everything out and ceramics have to be washed and chairs hoovered and everything put back into place again for the house opening.
When visitors come to the house now, this is where they begin their tour, in the breakfast room. But there are lots of telltale signs that this is no longer a room for bacon and eggs and liver and sausage and kedgeree and kidneys and all the delicious ingredients of a 5- and 6-course breakfast. Instead, there are display cabinets and leaflets on how to join the National Trust. But this is a useful reminder that this great house will survive because it is in the care of the National Trust, and that there are many other houses throughout Ireland like this which now lie derelict and destroyed because their owners couldn't afford to look after them. Castle Coole is valuable, and not only in financial terms. It's because it's a treasure house of historical fact, which lets us know how our ancestors, both upstairs and downstairs, lived over the last 200 years. Thank you.